Here we join Barry as he cruises the private roads on Hamilton Island, the motorcycle museum off the Great Barrier Reef, where he keeps his own collection of racing history.
Well, the old 1200cc Harley and sidecar, and the Yanks call it the Freedom Machine. Well, quite frankly, the only time I'd want to ride it, if I was trying to escape from somewhere, it's like driving a lorry. One of the old bikes I didn't mind riding was this lovely little thing here. It's my 125cc X-Factory Suzuki, and it was really the bike that put me on the road to fame and fortune, if you like. I bought it off of a guy called Stuart Graham in England. He used to race for the Suzuki factory, and it's a 125cc, 10-speed, twin-cylinder, and it cost me £2,000 in 1970, and it was all my dad's life savings. So I borrowed the money off of dad, hoping that I'd earn enough money to pay it back, and sure enough I did. I rode it in the World Championships in 1971, and I led the World Championship right up until the last race. And gearbox sprocket broke, and I ended up finishing second. But all the year, it never ever broke down at all. I had a mechanic that was a good mate of mine, Donnie's name was. Terrific guy, he didn't know anything about motorbikes though, that was the only problem. So it's very dear to my heart, this bike, because before every Grand Prix, I used to strip the engine, put new crankshafts in it, and generally look after it like it was a little baby. Then at the end of 71, I got offered a ride by Yamaha's. So I sold this thing to a guy in Italy. Then in sort of 72, I didn't have a very good season. 73, I started to earn some money. And I thought, what an idiot I was to sell my little bike. So I paid £6,500 to buy it back. And out of all my bikes, this one really means the most to me. After a really disastrous year in 1972 with Yamaha, I signed up to ride for Suzuki Great Britain, and this was the bike that I rode. It was a really nice bike, it was 750, and I'd never raced a 750 before. A lot of people were saying because I'd ridden 125s and 250s that I wouldn't be able to ride a 750. Cut a long story short, at the end of the year I won the first ever European 750cc championship on it, and also the British Superbike Series, which then was the most prestigious thing in the big bike class to win. So it shut a few people up. This is my factory 500 Suzuki from 1978. It was not a bad bike, actually. It was supposedly slightly better than the 1977 model on which I won the World Championship. We lost the championship in 78. To Yamaha's and Kenny Roberts, but wasn't a bad old bike. There was a lot of things that should have been done to it that weren't done to it through my relationship with the Japanese, you'll understand. But all in all, not a bad old bike. Then I changed at the end of 1979 after really sort of suffering from overboard Japanese lack of fidelity, I guess, in that no matter what you said technically about the bike, to improve it, it would just go, don't want to know. So anyway, cut long story short, I ended up riding for Yamaha in 80, 81 and 82 and crashed very badly at Silverstone, nearly losing my legs. And then I went back to Suzuki, and this was my last year's bike, my 1984 bike. 84 was my last year of racing. Suzuki pulled out of Grand Prix racing at the end of 83. And they gave me sort of a two-year-old engine to put a frame around. And the great thing about this bike was in actual fact the frame. It was made by a British company called the Harris Performance Specialists or whatever. And it was two brothers, Lester and his brother Steve. They made a fantastic job because they listened to everything that I wanted about the rigidity and the strength. Half of the problem with most of the Japanese bikes, they were never strong enough. You know, the forks would bend back. The whole frame would twist because they had a lot of horsepower. They were great at getting horsepower, but they didn't have the foggiest idea about sorting out the geometry of steering and getting the bikes to handle, which luckily enough was my forte. And last but not least, this is my 500 championship winning bike from 1976. It's Suzuki 500. And it was the first year, 1976, that Suzuki had ever won the 500cc championship. I also won it again for them in 77, but that bike's at my house on the Gold Coast. This is a four-cylinder 500. It's bore and stroke is what they call sort of square, in that the bore is the same as the stroke. It was, what can you say, I suppose the forerunner of the modern-day 500. Rotary valve engine, produced about 120 brake horsepower. The handling of this bike was not too bad at all. The biggest criticism you could have of the Japanese racing bikes, the fact they just didn't make them strong enough. You know, their prime objective was to have A, a lot of horsepower, and B, to be light. Well, that's all very well if you can have it light, a lot of horsepower, and also strong. The strength in a racing motorbike is one of the most important things. You could have a bike that weighed, I don't know, 30 kilos more than another one, but it's handled better. And when you have a bike that handles, that's what wins races. Anyhow, this is my collection of bikes, and I like to feel that it's a bit unique, really, because as far as I can remember, there's none of the sort of world champions or bike racers from the past that have managed to keep all their racing bikes. And I had it, used to have it written into my contract that I kept my bike at the end of the year. Right, well, that's my collection of bikes. I hope you like them, because they really mean an awful lot to me.